Welcome to the University of Laverne Theater's production of Shakespeare's Twelfth Night. There will be one 10-minute intermission with restroom facilities near the theater entrance in the sports pavilion. Please turn off your cell phones now, not on my way, and come back soon for upcoming productions of Samuel Beckett's Happy Days on May 13th through the 15th, just outside this theater, and a fabulous group of one acts on the week of May 17th to the 21st. Thank you, and enjoy.
Which she would keep fresh and lasting in her sad remembrance.
Oh,
She that hath the heart of that fine frame to pay this debt of love but to a brother? How will she love when the rich golden shaft hath killed the flock of all affections else that live in her? When liver, brain, and heart, these sovereign thrones are all supplied and filled her sweet perfections with oneself king. Away, before me, sweet beds of flowers. Love thoughts lie rich when canopied with bowers.
Yeah!
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 Mellow, which my estate is.
That were our compass, for she
Yet of thee, I will believe thou hast a mind that suits with this thy fair and outward character.
Stop.
I prithee, and I will pay thee bounteously. Conceal me what I am, and be my aid for such disguise as haply shall become the form of my intent. I'll serve this duke. Thou shalt present me as an eunuch to him. It may be worth thy pains, for I can sing and speak to him in many sorts of music that will allow me very worth his service. What else may hap to time I will commit? Only shape thou thy silence to my wit.
Be you his eunuch, and your mute I'll be. When my tongue blabs, then let mine eyes not see.
Oh, I thank thee. Lead me on.
Cares an enemy to life.
Sir Toby, you must come in earlier, O knight. Your cousin, my lady, takes great exceptions to your ill of hours.
Well, let her accept before accepted.
But you must confine yourself to the modest limits of order.
Confine? I'll confine myself no finer than I am. These clothes be good enough to drink in, and so be these boots, too. And they be not, let them hang themselves in their own straps.
That coffee and drinking won't do you. I heard my lady talk of it yesterday. And of a foolish knight you brought in one night to be her wooer.
Oh, Sir Andrew at your cheek?
Aye, me.
He's as tall a man as any's in Illyria.
What's that for the purpose?
Why, he has 3,000 ducats a year.
Aye, but he'll be but a year in all those ducats. He's a very fool and a prodigal.
Fie that you should say so. He plays the viol de gamboys, speaks 3 or 4 languages, word for word, without book, and he hath all the good gifts of nature.
He hath almost natural. For besides that he's a fool, he's a great quarreler. And pathetic hath the gift of a coward to allay the gust he hath in quarreling. To thought amongst the proof he would quickly have the gift of the grave.
By this hand, they are scoundrels and subtractors who say so of him. Who are they?
They that add, moreover, he's drunk nightly in your company.
With drinking healths to my niece, I'll drink so long as there is a passage in my throat, and drink in Illyria. Ah! He's a coward and a coister that will not drink to my niece till his brains turn to the toe like a parish tub. Ah, what, wench? Oh, casting on the Google, for here comes Sir Andrew.
Sir Toby Belch, how now, Sir Toby Belch?
Sweet Sir Andrew.
Bless you, fair shrew.
And you too, sir.
Accost, Sir Andrew, accost!
What's that?
My niece is chambermaid.
Oh, good mistress accost, I desire better acquaintance.
My name is Mary, sir.
Good mistress Mary accost.
You mistake, knight. Accost is, fronter, boarder, sailor.
By my troth, I would not undertake her in this company. Is this the meaning of accost?
Very well, gentlemen.
Never draw sword again!
Then part thou so, mistress, would that I might never draw sword again? Fair lady, do you think you have fools in hand?
Sir, I have you not by the hand.
Mary, but you shall have, and here's my hand.
Now, sir, thought is free. Pray, bring your hand to the buttery bar and let it drink.
Oh, wherefore, sweetheart? What's your metaphor?
It's dry, sir.
I'm not such an ass that I can keep my hand dry. What's your jest?
A dry jest, sir.
Are you full of them?
I have them at my fingers' end. Mary, now I let go your hand and I am married.
Oh, knight, I see thee lackest a cup of canary. When have I seen thee so put down?
Never in your life, I should think, unless you see canary put me down. Yeah. Methinks sometimes I have no more wit than a Christian, or an ordinary man. But I am a great eater of beef, and I believe that does harm to my wit.
Pass question.
And I thought that I'd forswear it. I'll ride home tomorrow, Sir Toby.
Pourquoi, dear knight?
Pourquoi? What is pourquoi? Do or not do? I would that I had bestowed the time and the tongues that I have in fencing, dancing, bear baiting. Had I but followed the arts.
Then hadst thou an excellent head of hair?
Why, would that have mended my hair?
Pass question! For thou see, it will not curl by nature.
But it befits me well enough, does it not?
Excellent! It hangs like flex on distaff. And I would see a housewife take it between her legs and spin it off.
Faith, I'll ride home tomorrow, Sir Toby. Oh. Your niece will not be seen. If she be, it's 4-1. She'll none of me. The count himself here hard by woos her.
Still none of the cows. She'll not match above her degree, neither in estate, years, nor wit. I've heard her swear it. Touch! There's life in it, man.
I'll stay a month longer. I'm a fellow of the strangest mind in the world. I delight in revels and masks sometimes altogether.
I'm not good at these kickshaws, is dear knight.
As good as any man in Illyria, whatsoever he be, under the degree of my betters, yet I will not compare with an old knack. Well,
what is thy excellence in a galliard, dear knight?
In faith, I can cut a caper.
And I can cut the mutton to it.
And I have the back trick simply as strong as any man in Illyria.
Wherefore are these things hid? Wherefore have these gifts a curtain before them? Are they to take dust, like Mistress Maul's picture? Why dost thou not go to church in a galliard and come home in a coranto? My very walk should be a jig. I'll not so much as make water, but as sink a place. What dost thou mean? That it's a world for hiding virtues in? I did think that by the very excellent constitution of thy leg, it was formed under the star of a galleon.
Aye, 'tis strong and does indifferent well in flame-colored stock. Shall we set about some revels?
What shall we do else? Were we not born under Taurus?
Taurus, that sides and heart.
No, sir. These legs and thighs, come, let me see thee caper. Ha ha! Ha! Excellent!
Return. Say I do speak with her, my lord. What then?
Oh, then,
my love. Surprise her with the discourse of my dear fate.
Shall become thee well to act my woes. She will attend better in thy youth than in a nuncio's of more grave aspect.
I think not so, my lord.
Dear lad, believe it. They shall yet belie thy happy years and say thou art a man. Diana's lip is not more smooth and rubious. Thy small pipe is as the maiden's organ shrill and sound in all is semblant to the woman's part.
Oh, I know thy constellation is right up for this affair. Some 4 or 5 attend him, all if you will, for I myself am best when least in company.
Prosper well in this, and thou shalt live as freely as thy lord to call his fortunes thine.
I'll do my best to woo your lady. Yet a barful strife, whoe'er I woo, myself would be his wife.
Nay, either tell me where thou hast been, or I will not open my lips so wide as a bristle may enter in the way of thy excuse. My lady will hang me for being so long absent.
Oh, let her hang me. He that is well hanged in this world needs to fear no colors.
Yet you will be hanged for being so long absent.
Oh, many a good hanging prevents a bad marriage.
You're resolute, yeah. Lord.
So, neither. But I am resolved on 2 points.
That if one holds, the other will break. And if they both break, your gas will fall.
Oh, act in good faith. Very apt. Well, go thy way. If Sir Toby were to leave drinking, thou wert as witty a piece of Eve's flesh as any in Illyria.
Please, you rogue, no more of that. Here comes thy lady. She must make your excuse wisely for best.
Winton be thy will. Put me into good wood.
Ah, God bless thee, lady.
Take the fool away.
Did you not hear, gentlemen? Take away the lady.
Go to your dry, fool. I'll know more of you. Besides, you grow dishonest.
2 faults, Madonna, that drink and good counsel will amend. Forgive the dry fool drink. Ben is the fool not dry. Ben, the dishonest man, mend himself. If he mend, he is no longer dishonest. Cannot, let the tailor mend him. The lady may take away the fool, gentlemen. Therefore, I say again, take her away.
Sir, I bade them take away you.
Miss Prision, in the highest degree, Lady Cuculus, non bashi monacum. Much as to say, we're not bluntly in my brain. Good Madonna, give me leave to prove you the fool.
Can you do it?
Dexterously, good Madonna.
Make your proof.
I must catechize you for a good Madonna. My mouse of virtue, answer me.
Sir, for want of other idleness, I'll bide your proof. Ooh.
Good Madonna, why mournest thou?
Good fool, for my brother's death.
I think his soul's in hell, Madonna.
I know his soul is in heaven, fool.
Ah, but more fool, Madonna. Mourn for your brother's soul being in heaven. Take away the fool, gentlemen.
What think you of this fool, Malvolio? Doth he not mend?
Yes, and shall do, till the pangs of death shake him. Infirmity that decays the wise doth ever make the better fool.
God send you a speedy infirmity, for the better increasing your folly. Sir Toby will be sworn that I am no fox, but he will not pass his word for 2 pence that you're no fool.
What say you to that, Malvolio?
I marvel your ladyship takes delight in such a barren rascal. I saw him put down the other day with an ordinary fool that has no more brain than a stone. Look you now, he is already out of his guard. Unless you laugh and minister occasion to him, he is gagged. I protest, I take these wise men that crow so at these said kind of fools no better than a fool's zanies.
Oh, you are sick of self-love, Malvolio, and taste with a distempered appetite. To be guiltless, generous, and of free disposition, is to take those things for bird bolts that you deem cannon bullets. There is no slander in an allowed fool, though he do nothing but rail, and no railing in a known discreet man, though he do nothing but reprove.
Now, Mercury, endue thee with leasing, for thou speakest well of fools.
Madam, there is at the gate a young gentleman much desired to speak with you.
From the Count Orsino, is it?
I know not, madam. He's a very young man and well attended.
Who of my people holds him in delay?
Sir Toby, madam, your kinsman.
Fetch him off! He speaks nothing but madness. Fie on him! will to dismiss it.
Gentlemen.
Gentlemen? What gentleman?
There's a gentleman here that... Look at these pickled herrings. Oh, no! Silence!
Cousin, how came you so early by this letter?
Lechery? I defy lechery! There's one at the gate! Let him be the devil, and he will, I care not. Give me fate, say I. Well, tis all one.
What is a drunken man like, fool?
Like a drowned man, a fool, and a madman. One draught above heat makes him the fool. The second mads him, the third drowns him.
Then go thee and seek the coroner, and let him sit on my cuz, for he is in the third degree of drink, he's drowned. Go, look after him.
He is the mad yet, Madonna, and so the fool shall look to the madman.
Madam, yon young fellow swears he will speak with you. I told him you were sick. He takes on him to understand so much, and therefore comes to speak with you. I told him you were asleep. He seems to have a foreknowledge of that too, and therefore comes to speak to you. What is it to be said to him? He's fortified against any denial.
Tell him he shall not speak with me.
Has been told so, and he says he'll stand at your door like a sheriff's post and be the supporter to a bench, but he'll speak with you.
What kind of man is he?
Why, of mankind.
What manner of man?
A very ill manner. He will speak to you, will you or no?
Of what personage and years is he?
Not yet old enough for a man, nor young enough for a boy, as a squash is before 'tis almost a peas pod, or a pooling when 'tis almost an apple. 'Tis within, in standing water between boy and man. He is very well favored and speaks very shrewishly. One would think his mother's milk were scarce out of him.
Let him approach, and call in my gentlewoman.
Gentlewoman! My lady calls.
Come, give me my veil, throw it o'er my face. We shall once more hear Orsino's embassy. The honorable lady of the house, which is she? Speak to me, I shall answer for her, your will.
Most radiant, exquisite, and unmatchable beauty. I pray you, tell me if this be the lady of the house, for I never saw her. I would be loath to cast away my speech, for besides that it is excellently well penned, I have taken great pains to con it. Good beauties, let me sustain no scorn. I am very comfortable even to the least sinister usage.
Whence came you, sir?
I can say little more than I have studied, and that question's out of my part. Good gentle one, give me modest assurance if you be the lady of the house that I may proceed in my speech.
Are you a comedian?
No. My profound heart. And yet, by the very fangs of malice, I swear I am not that I play. Are you the lady of the house?
If I do not usurp myself, I am.
Most certain, if you are she, you do usurp yourself. For what is yours to bestow is not yours to reserve. But this is from my commission. I will on with my speech in your praise, and then show you the heart of my message.
Come to what is important in it, I'll forgive you the praise.
Alas, I took great pains to study it, and 'tis poetical.
Is the more like to be feigned. I pray you, keep it in. I heard you were saucy at my gates, and allowed your approach rather to wonder at you than to hear you. If you be not mad, be gone. If you have reason, be brief. 'Tis not that time of moon with me to make in one so skipping a dialogue.
Will you hoist sail, sir? Here lies your way.
No good swabber, I am to hold here a little longer. Some mollification for your giant, sweet lady.
Tell me your mind.
I'm a messenger.
Sure you have some hideous matter to deliver, since the courtesy of it is so fearful. Speak your office.
It alone concerns your ear. I bring no overture of war, no taxation of homage. I hold the olive in my hand. My words are as full of peace as matter.
Yet you began rudely. What are you? What would you?
The rudeness that hath appeared in me have I learned from my entertainment. What I am and what I would are as secret as maidenhood. To your ears, divinity. To any others, profanation.
Give us this place alone. We will hear this, divinity. Now, sir, what is your text?
Most sweet lady!
A comfortable doctrine, and much may be said of it. Where lies your text?
In Orsino's bosom.
In his bosom? In what chapter of his bosom?
To answer by method in the first of his heart.
Oh, I have read it. It is heresy.
Have you no more to say?
Good madam, let me see your face.
Have you any commission from your lord to negotiate with my face? You are now out of your text.
But we will draw the curtain and show you the picture. Look you, sir, such a one I was this present. Is't not well done?
Excellently done,
if God did all.
'Tis engraved, sir, 'twill endure wind and weather.
'Tis beauty truly blent, whose red and white nature's own sweet and cunning hand laid on. Lady, you are the cruelest she alive. If you would leave these graces to the grave and leave the world no copy.
Oh, sir, I will not be so hard-hearted. I will give out divers schedules of my beauty, and every particle and utensil shall be inventoried to my will and labeled as item, two lips, indifferent red. Item, two gray eyes with lids to them. Item, one neck, one chin, and so forth. Were you sent hither to appraise me?
I see you what you are. You are too proud.
But if you were the devil, you are fair.
My lord and master loves you. Oh, such love could be but recompense, though you are crowned the nonpareil of beauty.
How does he love me?
With adorations,
fertile tears, with groans that thunder love, with sighs of fire. Your lord does know my mind. I cannot love him. Yet I suppose him virtuous. Know him noble, of great estate, of fresh and stainless youth, in voices well divulged, free, learned, and valiant, and in dimension and shape of nature, a gracious person. And yet, I cannot love him. He might have took his answer long ago.
If I did love you in my master's flame, with such a suffering, such a deadly life, in your denial, I would find no sense. I would not understand it.
Why? What would you?
Make me a willow cabin at your gate and call upon my soul within the house. Write loyal cantons of contemned love and sing them loud, even in the dead of night. Hallow your name to the reverberate hills and make the babbling gossip of the air cry out. Olivia! You should not rest between the elements of air and earth, but you should pity me.
You might do much. What is your parentage?
Above my fortunes, yet my state as well. I am a gentleman.
Get you to your lord. I cannot love him, let him send no more. Unless, perchance, you come to see me again? To tell me how he takes it. I thank you for your pains. Fare you well. Spend this for me.
I am no feed post, lady. Keep your purse. My master, not myself, lacks recompense. Love make his heart a flint that you shall love, and let your fervor, like my master's, be placed in contempt. Farewell. Fair cruelty.
and I'll be sworn thou art. Thy tongue, thy face, thy limbs, actions, and spirits do give thee fivefold blazon!
Not too fast.
Unless the master were the man. How now? Even so quickly may one catch the plague? Methinks I feel this youth's perfections with an invisible and subtle stealth to creep in at mine eye. Oh well, let it be. What ho, Malvolio?
Here, madam, at your service.
Run after that same peevish messenger, the county's man. He left this ring behind him, would I or no. Tell him I'll none of it. Desire him not to flatter with his lord, nor to hold him up with hopes. I am not for him. If that youth will come this way tomorrow, I'll give him reasons for it. Hie thee, Malvolio.
Madam, I will.
I do, I know not what, and fear to find mine eye too great a flatterer for my mind. Fate, show thy force. Ourselves we do not owe. What is decreed must be. But be this so.
She much resembled me. She was yet of many account and beautiful. But though I could not with much estimable wonder over far believe that, I will thus far boldly publish her. She bore a mind that envy could not be called fair. She is drowned already, sir, with salt water. Though I seem to drown her remembrance again more.
Pardon me, sir, your bad entertainment.
Oh, good Antonio, forgive me your trouble.
If you will not murder me for my love, then let me be your servant.
If you will not undo what you have done, that is, kill him whom you have recovered, then desire it not. Fare ye well at once. My bosom is full of kindness. Yet I am so near the madness of my mother that upon the least occasion more mine eyes will tell tales of me. I am bound to the Count Orsino's court. Farewell!
Let the gentleman escort me! I have many enemies in Orsino's court. Else would I very shortly see thee there. Oh,
A love song!
Aye, a love song!
I
care not for a good life.
Hit it.
Wow.
round with you. My lady bade me tell you that though she harbors you as her kinsman, she's nothing allied to your disorders. If you can separate yourself and your misdemeanors, you are welcome to the house. If not, and it would please you to take leave of her, she is very willing to bid you farewell.
Farewell, dear hearts, as I must needs be gone.
His lives do show his days are almost done.
This is even so.
But I will never die.
Arthur, tell me where you lie.
This is much credit to you.
Shall I bid him go?
What did you do?
Shall I bid him go and spare not?
No, 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 you dare not.
Out of tune, sir. You lie. Art a more than a steward. Thinkest thou, because thou art virtuous, that there shall be no more cakes than ale?
Yes, by Satan, and ginger shall be hot in the mouth too.
Thou art in the right. Go, sir, rub your chain with crooks. A stoop of wine, Maria.
Mistress Mary, if you prized my lady's favor at anything more than contempt, you would not give means to this uncivil rule. She shall know of it by this hand.
Go shake your ears.
Yeah!
'Tis as good a deed as to drink when a man's a hungry.
To challenge him in the field, and then break promise and make a fool of him.
You it, knight. I'll write thee a challenge, or I'll deliver thy indignation to him by word of mouth.
Sir Toby, be patient for tonight. Since the youth of the count was today with my lady, she's much out of quiet. Poor Monsieur Malvolio, leave him to me. If I do not gull him into a nay word and make him a common recreation, do not think I have enough wit to lie straight in my bed. I know I can do it.
Possess us! Possess us! Tell us something of him.
Nay, sir, sometimes he is a kind of curate.
Oh, if I thought that I'd beat him like a dog!
What? For being a Puritan? Thy most exquisite reason, dear knight.
I have no exquisite reason for it, but I have reason good enough.
The devil a Puritan that he is, or anything constantly, but a time pleaser, an affectioned ass, the best persuaded of himself, so crammed as he thinks with excellencies, that it is his grounds of faith that all that look upon him love him. It is on that vice that my revenge will find beautiful cause to work.
What will thou do?
I will drop in his way some obscure epistles of love, wherein by the color of his beard, the shape of his leg, the manner of his gait, the expression of his eye, forehead, and complexion, he shall see himself most feelingly impersonated. I can write very like my lady or niece, but on a forgotten matter we can hardly make the distinction of our hands.
Excellent! I smell a device!
I have it in my nose too.
He shall think that by the letters that thou wilt drop, that they come from my niece, and that she's in love with him!
My purpose is indeed a horse of that color.
And your horse would now make him an ass.
Ass, my God.
To the Emperor.
He's Port Royal, I warn you. I know my physical work with him. I will plant you two, and let the fool make a third, where he shall find the letter. Observe his construction of it. And for tonight, to bed and dream of the event. Farewell.
Good night, Penthesilea.
For me, she's a good wench.
She is a beagle. And one one that adores me. What of that?
I was adored once, too.
Come, knight! Let's to bed. Thou hast need to send for more money.
If I cannot recover your niece, I am a foul way out.
Send for money, knight! If thou hast her not in the end, call me cut.
And I do not. Never trust me. Take it how you will.
Come. I'll burn some sack. It is too late to go to bed now. Come, knight. Come, knight.
By a fair cool maid. had a flower on my black coffin shone. Not a friend to greet my poor old bones. Come away, come away, dear. Fly away, fly away. Thousand sighs to save. Sad true love, I'll never find my grave.
Sir, I take pleasure in saving, sir.
I'll pay thy pleasure, then.
Truly, sir, and pleasure will be paid, one time or another.
Give me now leave to leave thee.
Now the melancholy, God protect thee, and the tailor make thy doublet of changeable taffeta, for thy mind is a very hopeful. Really well.
Let all the rest give place. Once more, Cesario. Get thee to yon same sovereign cruelty. Tell her, my love, more noble than the world, prices not quantity of dirty lands. The parts that fortune hath bestowed upon her, tell her, I hold as giddily as fortune. But 'tis that miracle and queen of gems that nature pranks her and attracts my soul.
But if she cannot love you, sir?
Cannot be so answered.
Sooth, but you must. Say that some lady, as perhaps there is, hath for your love as great a pang of heart as you have for Olivia. You cannot love her. You tell her so. Must she not then be answered?
There is no women's sides can bide the beating of so strong a passion as love doth give my heart. No women's heart so big to hold so much. They lack retention. Alas, their love may be called appetite. No motion of the liver but the palate that suffers serpent cloyment and revolt. The mind is all as hungry as the sea, can digest as much. Make no compare between that love a woman can bear me and that I will live you.
Aye, but I know.
What dost thou know?
Too well what love women to men may owe. In faith, they are as true of heart as we. My father had a daughter loved a man. As it might be, perhaps, were I a woman, I should, your lordship.
And what's her history?
A blank, my lord. She never told her love, but let concealment, like a worm in the bud, feed on her damask cheek. She pined in thought, and with a green and yellow melancholy, she sat like patience on a monument, smiling at grief. Not this love, indeed. We men may say more, swear more, but indeed, our shows are more than will. For still, we prove much in our vows, but little in our love.
But died thy sister of her love, my boy?
I am all the daughters of my father's house, and all the brothers too. And yet, I know not.
Sir! Shall I to this lady?
Aye, that's the thing. To her in haste. Give her this jewel. Tell her my love can give no place by no delay. Oh.
Wouldst thou not be glad to see the notable sheep-biter come by some rascally shame?
I would exult, man. You know, he brought me out of favor with my lady over a bear baby.
To fool him, we'll have the bear again, and we shall anger him black and blue! Shall we not, Sir Andrew?
Then we do not. It is
pity of our lives.
Here you comes, my little villain. How now, my medal of India?
Take Ether into the box tree. Malvolio's coming down this walk. He has been yonder in the sun practicing behavior to his own shadow. Observe him for the love of mockery, for I know this letter will make you a contemplative idiot of him. Close in the name of Jesse! Lie down there, for here comes the trout that must be caught for tickling.
That's how we'll give him a punch in your little red hat.
Tis but fortune. All is fortune. Mariah once told me she did affect me, and I have heard her come thus near that, should she fancy, it should be one of my complexion. Besides, she uses me with a more exalted respect than anyone else that follows her. What should I think on it?
He's an overweening rogue!
Please, contemplation makes a rare turkey cock of him! Look how he jets under his advanced plume!
I can so beat the rogue!
Please.
To be Count Malvolio.
Ah, rogue!
Pistolin!
There is an example for it. The lady of the Strachey married the yeoman of the wardrobe.
Fie on him, Jezebel!
Peace, he's deeply in. Look how imagination blows him.
Having been 3 months married to her, sitting in my state.
Ah, for a stone bow that I could hit him in the eye.
Calling my officers about me in my branched velvet gown. Having come from a daybed where I have left Olivia sleeping.
Fire and brimstone!
Oh, peace!
And then, for the humor of state, after a demure travel of regard, telling them I know my place as I would they should do theirs, to ask for my kinsman, Toby.
Both said circles!
Seven of my, with an obedient start, make out for him. I frown the while and perchance wind up my watch or play with my some rich jewel. Toby approaches, curtsies there to me.
Shall this fellow live?
I extend my hand to him thus, quenching my familiar smile with an austere regard of control.
And does not Toby take you a blow on the lips then?
Say, cousin Toby, my fortunes having cast me on your niece, give me this prerogative of speech.
What? What?
You must amend your drunkenness.
I'm scared!
You waste the treasure of your time with a foolish knight.
Ooh, that's me, I warned you.
One Sir Andrew.
I knew it was I, for many do call me fool, and I...
What employment have we here?
Now is the woodcock near the gin.
Peace. In the spirit of good humor, intimate reading aloud in him.
By my life. This is my lady's hand. These be her very C's, her U's, her T's, and thus make she her great P's. It is in contempt of question her hand.
Her C's, her U's, her T's, why those? Boom!
To the unknown beloved, this and my good wishes, her very phrases. By your leave, wax. Oh. Soft, and the impressure of her Lucrece with which she uses to seal. Tis my lady. To whom should this be?
This wind's in liver at all.
Jove knows I love, but who? Lips, do not move. No man must know. No man must know. What follows? The numbers alter. No man must know if this should be thee, Malvolio.
Hey, thee, Brock!
I may command where I adore, but silence, like a Lucrece knife with bloodless stroke, my heart doth gore. M-O-A-K. I doth sway my life.
A Fustrian riddle!
Oh, excellent wench, say I.
M-O-A-I doth sway my life. Nay, but first, let me see.
Oh, what dish of poison has she dressed for him?
And with what wing does Daniel Tuck set it?
I may command where I adore. Oh, why, she may command me. I serve her. She is my lady. This is evident to any formal capacity. There is no obstruction in this. But then the end. What should that alphabetical position portend if I could make that resemble something in me? Sorry. M-O-A-I.
I make that obedience out of consent.
M, Malvolio. M! Why, that begins my name!
Did I not say he'd work it out? The cur is excellent at faults.
But then there is no consonancy in the sequel that suffers under probation. A should follow, but O does.
And O shall end it, I hope.
Aye, or I'll cudgel him and make him cry. Oh!
And then I comes behind.
Aye, and had you any eye behind you, you might see more detraction at your heels than fortune before you.
M-O-A-I. The simulation is not as the former. And yet, to crush this a little, it would bow to me, for every one of these letters are in my name. Oh, but soft, here follows prose. If this fall into thy hand, revolve. In my stars, I am above thee. But be not afraid of greatness. Some are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust upon them. Thy fates open their hands, let thy blood and spirit embrace them, and to inure thyself to what thou art like to be, cast thy humble sloth and appear fresh. Be opposite with the kinsmen, surly with servants. Let thy tongue tang arguments of state. Put thyself into the trick of singularity. She thus advises thee that sighs for thee. Remember who commended thy yellow stockings and wished to see thee ever cross-gartered. I say remember. Go to. Thou art made if thou desirest to be so. If not, let me see thee a steward still, the fellow of servants, and not worthy to touch fortune's fingers. Farewell, she that would alter services with thee, the fortunate unhappy. Daylight and champagne discovers not more. This is open. I will be proud. I will read politic authors.
Yes.
I will baffle Sir Toby. I will wash off gross acquaintance. I will be point device the very man. I do not now fool myself to let imagination jade me, for every reason excites to this, that my lady loves me. She did commend my yellow stockings of late, and she did praise them being cross-gartered, and in this she manifests herself to my love, and with a sort of injunction drives me to these very habits of her liking. I thank my stars, I am happy. I will be strange, stout, in yellow stockings and cross-gartered, even with the swiftness of putting on. Jove and my stars be praised. Here is yet a postscript. Thou canst not choose but know who I am. If thou entertainest my love, let it appear in thy smile. Thy smiles become thee well, Therefore, in my presence, still smile, dear my sweet, I prithee. Jove! I thank thee. I will smile. I will do everything that thou wilt have me.
Well begged.
I will consult
them whence you come, who you are, and what you would are out of my welkin. I might say element, sir, but
the word is overworn.
Oh, what's the price?
This fellow is wise enough to play the fool. And to do that well, crave the kind of wit.
Gentlemen, save me.
And you, sir.
You, Mr. Gardy, monsieur.
Et vous si, votre serviteur.
I hope, sir, you are, and I am yours.
Will you encounter the house? My niece is desirous you should enter, if your trade be to her.
I am bound to your niece, sir. I mean she is the list of my voyage.
Taste your legs, sir. Put them into motion.
My legs do better understand me, sir, than I understand what you mean by bidding me taste my legs.
I mean, sir, to go, to enter.
I will answer you with gated entrance, but we are prevented. Most excellent accomplished lady, the heavens rain odors on you.
That's you, sir, rare courtier, rain odors.
My matter hath no voice, lady, but to your own most pregnant and vouchsafed ear.
Pregnant? Vouchsafed? I'll get them all three already.
Let the garden door be shut and leave me to my hearing. Give me your hand, sir. My duty, madam, and most humble service.
What is your name?
Cesario is your servant's name, fair princess.
My servant? 'Twas never merry world since lowly feigning was called compliment. You are servant to the Count Orsino, you.
And he is yours, and his must needs be yours. Your servant's servant is your servant, madam.
For him, I think not on him. For his thoughts would they were blanks rather than filled with me.
Madam, I come to whet your gentle thoughts on his behalf.
By your leave, I prayed you. I bade you never again to speak of him. But would you undertake another suit? I would rather hear you solicit that than music from the spheres.
Dear lady.
Give me leave, beseech you. I did send after the last enchantment you did hear, a ring in chase of you. So did I abuse myself, my servant, and I fear me, you.
Under your hard construction must I sit. To force that on you in such a strange cunning, which you knew none of yours, what might you think?
Have you not set mine honor at the stake and baited it with all the unmuzzled thoughts that tyrannous hearts can think? To one of your receiving enough is shown. A cypress not a bosom hideth my heart, so let me hear you speak.
I pity you.
That's a degree to love.
No, not a grind, for 'tis vulgar proof that very oft we pity enemies.
Why, methinks 'tis time to smile again. Oh, how apt the poor are to be proud. If one should be a prey, it is all the better to fall before a lion than the wolf. Oh, this clock abrades me with the waste of time. Be not afraid, good youth, I will not have you. But when wit and youth come to harvest, your wife is like to reap a proper man. There lies your way, due west.
Then westward ho, grace and good disposition attend your ladyship.
Yield nothing, madam, to my lord by me.
Stay! For thee, that you do think you are not what you are.
If I think so, I think the same of you.
I think you right, I am not what I am.
And would you were what I would have you be.
Would it be better, madam, than I am? I wish it might, for now I am your fool.
Oh. Scorn looks beautiful in the anger and contempt of his lips.
A murderous guilt shows not itself more soon than love that would seem hid. Love's night is noon.
Cesario, by the roses of the spring, by maidhood, honor, truth, and everything, I love thee so that, maugre all thy pride, nor wit nor reason can my passion hide.
By my innocence, I swear, and by my youth, I have one heart, one bosom, and one one truth, and that no woman has, nor never none shall mistress be of it, save I alone. And so adieu, good madam. Nevermore will I my master's tears to you deplore.
Yet come again, for thou perhaps mayest move that heart which now abhors to like his love.
No, faith, I'll not stay and drop longer.
Thy reason, dear Henry.
Get that reason!
Your needs must yield your reason, Sir Andrew.
Mary, I saw your niece show more favor to the Count's serving man than ever she bestowed on me.
Did she see thee the while, old boy? Tell me that!
As clearly as I see you now.
Well, this was a great argument of love in her towards you.
Slight will you make an ass of me?
I will prove legitimate, sir, upon the oaths of judgment and reason.
Then they have been grand jurymen since before Noah was a sailor.
She did show favor to the youth in your sight only to exasperate you, to awaken that dormouse valor, to put fire in your heart and brimstone in your liver. Ah, you should have accosted her. And with some excellent jests, fire new from the mint, you should have bitten you into dumbness. This was looked for at your hand, and this was bought. The double guilt of this opportunity, you let time wash off. And now you've sailed into the north of my lady's opinion, where you will hang like an icicle on a Dutchman's beard. Unless, of course, you do redeem it by some laudable attempt at either valor or policy.
And it be anyway, it must be valor and policy I hate.
Why then, build me thy fortunes upon report of valor. Challenge me to count you to a fight. Hurt him in 11 places. My niece shall take note of it.
And assure thyself there is no love broker in the world can prevail more in man's commendation with woman in report of valor.
There's no way but this, Sir Andrew. Neither of you bear me a challenge to him.
Go, write it in a martial hand. Be curt and weak. It is no matter how brief, so it be eloquent and full of invention. Taunt him with a license of ink.
Where shall I bind you?
Well, call me if you can be below. Go!
This is a dear mannequin to you, Sir Toby.
I have been dear to him, lad, some 2,000 strong or so.
Yeah.
We shall have a rare letter from him.
But you'll not deliver it.
Never trust me, then.
And by all means, stir on the youth to answer. I think Oxen and Wainwright cannot hail the two together.
For Andrew, were he opened and you find so much blood in his liver as will clog the foot of a flea, I'll eat the rest of the anatomy.
And his opposite, the youth, bears in his visage no great presage of cruelty.
If you desire the spleen and will lap yourself in the stitches, follow me. Yon bull Malvolio has turned heathen. A very renegado, for there is no Christian that means to be saved by believing rightly can ever believe such impossible passages of grossness. He's in yellow stocking.
Yeah! Hey, cross garter!
Yeah. I have him that keeps the school in the church. I have dogged him like his murderer. He does obey every point dropped in the letter to betray him. He smiles his face into more lines than is in the new map of the augmentation of the Yankees.
Come, bring us where he is.
time I will have troubled you, but since you make pleasure of your pain, I will not let it shine. I could not stay behind you. I desire more sharp and filet steel than spur me forth. Not all love to see it, for so much I've drawn on a longer voyage, but jealousy of my folly travels. Being skillless in these parts, which to a stranger, unfriended and unguided, often prove rough and inhospitable, my willing love, rather by these arguments of fear, support in your pursuit. My kind Antonio, I can no other answer make but thanks, and thanks, and ever thanks. And off the turns I shuffled off with such uncurried pace. But were my worth as my conscience firm, you should find better dealing. What's to do? Shall we go see the relics of this town?
Tomorrow, sir! Let's first go see your lodging.
I am not weary, and 'tis long tonight. I pray you, let us satisfy our eyes with the memorials and things of fame that do renown this city.
Would you pardon me? I do not without danger walk these streets. Once in a sea battle against the Count his galleys, I did a service of such a note, were I taken here, it would scarce be answered.
Be like you slew a great number of his people.
The offense is not of such a bloody nature. Albeit the quality of time and quarrel might well have given us bloody argument, it might have since been answered in repaying what we took from them, which, for traffic's sake, most of our city did. Only myself stood out, which when I lapsed in this place, I shall pay dear.
Do not then walk too open.
It doth not fit me. Well, sir, here's my purse. Suburbs, the elephant is best to lodge. I will be speaker of diet. Well, so you be down all the time and feed your knowledge with news of the town. There you shall find me.
Why are your purse?
Well, happily your eye shall light upon some toy you desire to purchase. And your store, I think, is not for idle market, sir.
I'll be your purse bearer and leave you for an hour.
To the elephant.
I do remember.
I have sent after him. He says he'll come. How shall I feast him? What bestow of him? For you who's bought more off than beg nor borrow. I speak too loud. Where is Malvolio? He is sad and civil and suits well to a servant of my fortunes. Where is Malvolio?
He's coming, madam.
But
in a very strange manner, madam. He is surely possessed.
Why, what's the matter? Does he rave?
No, madam, he does nothing but smile. Your ladyship will be best to have some guard about her if he comes. The man is surely tainted in his wits.
Call him hither. I am as mad as he, if sad and merry madness equal be. Now, Malvolio.
Sweet lady.
Smilest thou? I sent for thee upon a sad occasion.
Sad? I could be sad. This does make some obstruction in the blood, this cross guard. But what of that? If it please the eye of one, it is with me as the very true sonnet is. Please one, please all.
Why, what's the matter with you, man? How dost thou?
Not black in my mind, though. Yellow in my leg. It did come into his hand, and commands shall be executed. I think we do know the sweet Roman hand.
Wilt thou go to bed, Malvolio?
To bed? Aye, sweetheart, and I will come to thee.
Oh, God comfort thee! Why dost thou smile so and kiss thy hand so oft?
How do you, Malvolio?
At your request, yes, nightingales answered dog.
Why appear you with such ridiculous boldness before my lady?
Be not afraid of greatness. 'Twas well writ.
What meanest thou by that, Malvolio?
Some are born great.
What say so?
Some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust. Remember who commended thy yellow stockings?
Thy yellow stockings.
And wish to see thee ever cross-gartered.
Cross-gartered.
Go to. Thou art made if thou desirest to be so.
Am I made?
If not, let me see thee a servant still.
Why, this is very midsummer madness.
Madam!
Ho!
The young gentleman at the Count Orsino's has returned. I could hardly entreat him back. He attends your ladyship's pleasure.
I'll come to him! Good Mariah, let this fellow be looked to.
Where is my cousin Toby? He has known my people take a special care of him. I would not have him miscarry for half of my dowry.
Oh ho! Do you come near me now? No worse man than Sir Toby to look to me. This concurs directly with the letter. She sends him on purpose that I may appear stubborn to him, for she incites me to that in the letter. Cast thy humble slough, says she. Be opposite with a kinsman, surly with servants. Let thy tongue tame arguments of state. Put thyself into the trick of singularity. I have lined her. But it is Jove's doing, and Jove make me thankful. And when she went away now, let this fellow be looked to. Fellow, not Malvolio, nor after my degree, but fellow. Why, everything adheres together, that no dram of a scruple, no scruple of a scruple, no obstacle or incredulous or unsafe circumstance. What can be said? Nothing that can be can come between me and the full prospect of my hopes. Well, Jove, not I, is the doer of this, and he is to be thanked.
Where is he? In the name of sanctity! If all the devils of hell be drawn in little, and Legion himself possessed him!
Here he is. How is it with you, sir? How is it with you, man?
Go! I discard you. Let me enjoy my private. Go off.
Look how hollow the fiend speaks within him. Did I not tell you, Sir Toby? My lady prays you have a care of him.
What does she say?
Go to. Hold that peace. This is not the way. We must deal gently with him. Let me alone. How now, Malvolio? How is it with you?
What, man? Defy the devil! Consider he's an enemy to mankind!
Do you know what you say?
Or why you speak ill of the devil, how he takes it at heart. Pray God, let me not be witch.
Carry his water to the wise woman!
Tomorrow, if I live, my lady will not consider more than I'll say.
How now, mistress?
Oh, Lord!
Prithee, hold thy peace. Do you not see how you move him? Let me alone. No way but gentleness. Gently. Gently. The fiend is rough
and will not be roughly used.
Prayers, minx!
No, I warned you, he will not hear of godliness!
Go hang yourself! yourselves all. You are idle, shallow things. I am not of your element. You shall know more hereafter.
It's possible!
If this were played upon a stage now, I could condemn it as an improbable fiction.
His very genius had taken the infection of the device man!
They pursue him now, lest the device be air and take.
Quiet, we shall drive him mad in me.
The house will be the quieter.
Come, come, we'll have him in a dark room and bound. My niece is already in the belief that he is mad. We may carry it thus for our pleasure and his penance, till our very pastime, tired, out of breath, prompts us to have mercy on him. At which time, we shall bring the device to the bar and crown thee as a finder of madman. But see, but see.
More letter from me, morning!
Here's the challenge, read it. I warrant there's vinegar and pepper in it.
Oh, is it so saucy?
Aye, is it? Do it, read.
Give me. Youth, whatsoever thou art but a scurvy fellow.
Good and valiant.
Wonder not, nor admire not that thou art. Why I do call thee so, for I will show thee no reason for it.
A good note that keeps you from the blow of the law.
Thou comest to the Lady Olivia, and in my sight she uses thee kindly, but thou liest in thy throat. That is not the matter I challenge thee for.
Very brief, and to exceeding good sense. Less.
I will waylay thee going home, where if it be thy chance to kill me.
Good.
Thou killest me like a rogue in a villain.
Still keeps you on the windy side of the law, good.
Fare thee well, and God have mercy upon one of our souls. He may have mercy upon mine, but my hope is better, and so I look to thyself. Thy friend, as thou usest him, and thy sworn enemy, Andrew Aguecheek. If this letter moves him not, his legs cannot, I'll get it him!
You may have very fit occasion for it,
since
some commerce with my lady will abide by your part.
Go, Sir Andrew. Scout me for him at the corner of the orchard like a bum bailey. So soon as ever thou seest him, draw. As thou drawest, swear horrible. Before it comes to pass off, that a horrid oath with a swaggering accent sharply twanged off gives manhood more approbation than ever proof itself would have earned him. Ah! Away!
Nay, let me alone for swearing.
Yeah.
Not so much brains as ear, lads.
Now will I not deliver this letter. Oh. For the behavior of the young gentleman gives him out to be of good capacity and breeding. His employment between his lord and my niece confirms no less. Therefore, this letter, being so excellently ignorant, will breed no terror in the youth. He will find it comes from a clod mold. But, sir, I will stir on the youth to answer and deliver his indignation to him by word of mouth. Set upon Aguecheek a notable report of valor and drive the young gentleman, as I know his youth is aptly to receive it, into a most hideous opinion of his rage, skill, fury, and impetuosity. This will so fright them both that they will kill one another by the look, like cockatrices.
Oh, here he comes with your niece. Get away till I take leave, and presently after.
I will meditate the while upon some horrid message for a terrorist. Yeah.
I have said too much into a heart of stone and laid mine honor too on sherry out. There is something in me that reproves my fault, but such a headstrong, potent fault it is that it but mocks reproof.
With the same behavior that your passion bears goes on my master's grief.
Here, wear this jewel for me. 'Tis my picture. Refuse it not that hath no tongue to vex you. And I beseech you, come again tomorrow. What shall you ask of me that I'll deny? Which honor save may upon asking give?
Nothing but this. Your true love
for my master!
And you, sir.
That defense thou hast, but take thee to it. Of what nature are the wrongs thou hast done him, I know not. But thy interceptor, bloody as the hunter, full of despite, attends thee at the orchard end. Dismount thy tuck, beware thy preparation, for thy opponent is quick, skillful, and deadly.
You mistake, sir. I am sure no man hath any quarrel to me. My remembrance is very free and clear from any image of offense done to any man.
You'll find it otherwise, sir, I assure you. Therefore, if you hold thy life at any price, betake you to your guard, for your opposite hath within him what youth, skill, strength, and wrath can furnish a man withal.
Consideration.
But he is a devil in private brawl. Souls and bodies hath he divorced. Three. And his incessment at this moment is so implacable that his satisfaction can be none but by pains of death and sepulchre.
Well, I will return again into the house and desire some conduct of the lady. I am no fighter. I have heard of some kind of men that put quarrels purposely on others to taste their valor. Be like this as a man of that court?
Sir, no. You will find his indignation derives itself out of a very competent injury. Therefore, get you on and give him his desire. That you shall not enter the house unless you undertake with me that which with as much safety you might enter here.
This is as uncivil as strange. Do I beseech you? Do me this courteous office as to know of the knight what my offense to him is. It is something of my negligence, nothing of my purpose.
I will do so. Signor Fabian, stay you by this gentleman till my return.
Pray you, sir. Do you know of this matter?
I know the knight is incensed against you, even to a mortal arbitrament. But nothing of the circumstance more.
I beseech you, what manner of man is he?
Nothing of that wonderful promise to read him by his form, as you are like to find proof of his valor.
He is indeed, sir, the most skillful. Bloody, and vain opposite that you could have found in any part of Illyria!
Will you walk towards him? I will make your peace with him if I can.
Oh, I shall be much bound to you for it. I am one that had rather go with Sir Priest than Sir Knight. I care not who knows much of my mettle.
Why, man, he is the very devil! I have not seen such a farrago. I had a pass with him, rapier, scabbard, and all, and he gave me a stuck-in with such a mortal motion that it is inevitable. And on the answer, he pays you as surely as your feet hit the ground they stand on. They say he has been offensive to the Sophie.
Oh. Hey, plague on it, I'll not meddle with him.
Aye, but he will not now be pacified. Maybe he can scarce hold him yonder.
Pox on it, and I thought he had been so valiant and cunning in fence, I'd have seen him damned ere I'd have challenged him. Him, let the matter slip, and I'll give him my horse, Great Capulet.
I'll make the motion. Stand here a while. Make a good show on it. This shall end without the perdition of souls.
Mary, I'll ride your horse as well as I ride you.
I have his horse to take up the quarrel. He is convinced the youth's the very devil.
And he is as horribly conceited of him.
Pants and looks pale as if a bear were at his heels. Mary, sir, there is no remedy. He will fight with you for an oath's sake. He had better bethought him of his quarrel, and he finds that to scarce be worth talking about. Therefore, draw for the sword of his mouth. Your test will not hurt you.
Pray God defend me. A little thing would make me tell them how much I lack.
Give ground if you seem furious.
Come, sir Andrew, there is no remedy. The gentleman will, for his honor's sake, have one bout with you. He cannot by the duello avoid it, but he has promised me, as he is a gentleman and a soldier, he will not hurt you. Come on, to it.
Pray God he keep us off.
I do assure you, to the captain.
I think he's gone.
you offend him, I for him and fire!
You? Why? What are you?
Why, sir, that poor love dares yet do more than you have heard him brag to you. He will.
Yay! If you be an undertaker, I am for you.
Hold her, Tony. Here comes the officer.
Ah, I'll be with you enough.
Hey, sir, put your sword up, if you please.
Nay, sir, I will. And that which I promise you, I will be as good as my word. She will bear you easily and range well.
This is the man. Do thy office.
Antonio, I arrest thee in the suit of Count Orsino.
You do mistake me, sir.
No, sir, no jot. I know your favor well, though now you have no sea cap on your head. Aha! Take him away. He knows I know him well.
I must obey.
No remedy, it must be answered. Great, it grieves me much more what I cannot do for you than befalls myself. I stand amazed. But be comforted.
Come, sir! Away!
Oh. I must continue to take money.
What money, sir? For the fair kindness you have showed me here and partly prompted by your present trouble. Out of my lean and low ability, I'll lend you something. My having is not much. I'll make division of my present with you. Hold, there's half my coffer.
Will you deny me now? Is it possible that my deserts you cannot persuasion? Do not tempt my misery, lest that make me so unsound a man. I shall upbraid you of the kindnesses I have given you.
I know of none, nor know I you by voice or any feature.
Oh, heavens themselves!
Come, sir, I pray you, go!
Let me speak a little! This youth that you see here, I snatched one half out of the jaws of death, relieved him with such sanctity of love, and to his image, which methought did promise such venerable worth, did I devotion.
What's that to us? The time goes by. Away!
But oh, how vile an idol proves his God! Thou hast, Sebastian, done good feature shame. Nature, there's no blemish but the mind. None to be called the fourth, but the unkind. Leave me alone!
Methinks his words do from such passion fly that he believes himself. Oh, so do not I. Prove true, imagination, oh, prove true that I, dear brother, be now taken for you.
Come here, knight. Come hither, Signor Fabian. We'll whisper over a couple of the two of the most sage dogs.
He named Sebastian. I, my brother, know yet living in my glass. Even such and so in favor was my brother, and he went still in this fashion color ornament for him I imitate. Oh, if it prove, tempests are kind, and salt waves fresh in love.
A very dishonest and paltry boy, and more a coward than a hare. His dishonesty shows in him leaving his friend in necessity and denying him, and for his cowardship, ask Fabian.
A coward? Most about coward. Religious in it. Oh, slid, I'll after him again and beat him.
Do so. Cuff him soundly, but never draw thy sword.
And I do not.
Come, let's see your bed.
I will lay any money on it. It will be nothing yet.
Go to, go to. Thou art a foolish fellow. Let me be clear of thee.
Well, how that it be? No, I do not know you. Nor I am not sent to you by my lady to bid you come speak with her. Nor your name is not Master Cesario. Oh, no, this is not my knowledge neither. That is so and so.
I prithee, vent thy folly somewhere else. Thou knowest not me.
Vent my folly? He has heard this word from a great man and now applies it to a fool. Vent my folly? I pray thee, ungird thy strangeness and tell me what I shall vent to my lady. Shall I vent to her that thou art coming?
I pray thee, foolish Greek, depart from me. There's money for thee.
Ooh.
If you tarry any longer, I shall give you worse payment.
By my troth, thou hast an open hand. These wise men that give fools money get themselves a good report. Not the 14 years' purchase.
There he is. Get. How now, sir? Have I met you again? There's for you.
And that's for thee. Oh. And there! And there! What? Are all these people mad?
Come, sir, or
for 2 pence.
No.
Come on, sir, hold!
Nay, let him alone. I'll go another way against him. I'll have an action of battery against him if there be any law in Illyria. Though I struck him first, yet it's no matter for that.
Let go my hand!
Come on, sir, I will not let you go. Come on, my young soldier, you are well flesh. Put up your sword, come on!
I will be free from thee!
What
wouldst thou now? If thou darest tell me further, draw thy sword!
What? I see I must have an ounce or two of this malapert blood from you!
Hold, Toby! On my life I charge thee, hold!
Madam?
Will it be ever thus? Ungracious wretch, fit for the mountains and barbarous hill, where manners ne'er were preached? Out of my sight! Be not meddled, dear Cesario. Rude fiend, be gone!
Okay, all right, go.
I prithee, gentle friend, let thy fair wisdom, not thy passion, sway in this uncivil and unjust extent against thy peace. Go with me to my house, and hear thou there how many fruitless pranks this ruffian hath botched up, that thou thereby mayest smile at this. Do not choose but go. Do not deny. Beshrew his soul for me. He started one more heart of mine in me.
What relish is in this? How runs the stream? Or I am mad. Wait, or else this is a dream. Let fancy still my sense and lead thee speak. If it be thus to dream, still let me sleep.
Nay, come, I prithee. Wouldst thou be ruled by me?
Madam, I will.
Oh, well, say so, and so be.
Yeah.
Nay, I prithee, put on that bearded gown and make him believe that Sir Toke has a curate. Do it quickly. I'll call Sir Toby in the vault.
Well, I'll put it on, and I will dissemble myself in it. But I would I were the first that ever dissembled in such a gown.
It's your bless thee, Master Parson.
Well, Althea.
All the form of a prog that never saw a pen and ink wittily said to a niece of King Garbadoc that that is it. So I, being Master Parson, am Master Parson. For what is that but that I is but if?
To him, Sir Topaz.
What ho, I say, hasten this prison.
Who calls there?
Sir Tope is the curate, who comes to visit Malvolio, the new...
Sir Topaz, good Sir Topaz, go to my lady.
I'll talk about the thing. How vexest thou this man? Talkest thou nothing but of lady?
Well said, Master Parson.
Sir Topaz, never was man thus wronged. Good Sir Topaz, do not think I am mad. They have laid me here in hideous darkness.
By thou dishonest Satan!
I call thee by the most modest of terms, for I am one of those gentle ones, though he's a devil himself with courtesy.
Say it now, my house is dark.
As hell, Sir Topaz.
Why, it hath bay windows, transparent as barricados, and the clear stars toward the south, north, or as lustrous as ebony. Yet, convinced thou of obstruction?
I am not mad, Sir Topaz. I say to you, this house is dark.
Madman, thou errest. I say there was no darkness but ignorance, for which thou art more puzzled than the Egyptians and their fog.
And I say this house is dark as ignorance, though ignorance were as dark as hell. And I say there was never a man thus abused. I am no more mad than you are. Make a trial of it, in any constant question.
What is the opinion of Pythagoras concerning wildfowl?
That the soul of our grandam might happily inhabit a bird.
And what thinkest thou of his opinion?
I think nobly of the soul, and no way approve his opinion.
Very well. Remain thou still, Doctor. Thou shalt call the opinion of Pythagoras, ere I will allow thy wits and fears to the woodcock, lest thou dispossess the soul of thy grand heir. Very well.
Sir Topaz! Sir Topaz!
My most exquisite Sir Topaz.
May I have for all water?
He could have done it without the beard and gown. He's ZZ not.
To him in thine own voice, and bring me word on how thou findest him. I would we were well rid of this knavery. If he may be conveniently delivered, I would he were, for I am so far in offense with my niece that I cannot pursue with any safety this sport to the upshot.
Come by and by to my chamber.
Hey, Robin, jolly Robin, tell me how my lady does.
Fool.
My lady's on comforty.
Fool.
At last, what is she so?
Fool, I say.
That was another. Who calls, huh?
Good fool. As ever thou wilt deserve well in my hand, help me to a candle, and pen, ink, and paper. As I am a gentleman, I will live to be thankful to thee for it.
Oh, Master Malvolio!
Aye, good fool.
Oh, but as well, then you'd be no more better in your wits than a fool.
Good fool. There has never been a man so notoriously abused. I am as well in my wits, fool, as thou art.
Oh, by what you say, sir, the minister is here. My wits I have in the store, and devil thyself to sleep, and leave my babe, bibble, babble.
Sir Topaz!
Maintain no words with him, good fellow. I, sir?
No, not I, sir.
God be with you.
Have you met, sir?
I will, sir. I will.
Fool. Fool. Fool, I say.
Ah, sir, be patient. What say you, sir? I am shent for speaking to you.
Good fool. Help me to some light and favor. I tell thee, I am as well in my wits as any man in Illyria.
Well, the day that you were, sir.
By this hand, I am. Good fool. Some ink, paper, and light, and convey what I will set down to my lady. It will advantage thee more than ever bearing of letter did.
Well, I'll help you to it. But tell me truth. Are you not that indeed? Or do you have a counterfeit?
Believe me, I am not. I tell thee true.
Nay, I'll never believe a madman till I see his brains. I'll bet you light, paper, and ink.
Fool, I'll requite it in the highest degree. I prithee, be gone.
Oh, I am gone, and unknown. I'll be with you again, sir, unknown. In a trice, like, just like the old vice, your life, your need is only to sustain. So remain and refrain. I'll return to you, will learn just the same. As you will, so you can be sure, sir. I am gone, then I'll be back again. I am gone, and unknown. I'll be with you again, sir, unknown. In a trice, like, just like the old vice, your life, your need here soon to sustain. So remain and refrain. I'll return, you will learn just the same. As you were, sir, you can be sure, sir. I am gone and I'll be back again, unknown.
This is the air. That is the glorious sun. This pearl she gave me, I do feel it and see it. And though 'tis wonder that enwraps me thus, yet 'tis not madness. Where's Antonio there? I could not find him at the elephant, yet there he was. And there I found this credit that he did ring to town to seek me out. His counsel now might do me golden service, for though my soul disputes well with my sense, that this may be some error, but no madness. Yet doth this accident and flood of fortune so far exceed all instance, all discourse, that I am ready to distrust mine eyes and wrangle with my reason, that persuades me to any other trust but that I am mad. Or else the lady's mad. Yet if 'twere so, she could not sway her house, command her followers, take and give back affairs and their dispatch with such a smooth, discreet, and stable bearing as I perceive she does. There's something in it that is deceivable. But here the lady comes.
Blame not the taste of mine. If you mean well, go with me and with this holy man. Plight me the full assurance of your faith, that my most jealous and too doubtful soul might live at peace. He shall conceal it, whilst you are willing it shall come to note what time we shall keep a celebration according to my birth. What do you say?
I will follow this good man, and go with thee, and having sworn truth, ever will be true.
Then lead the way, good father! And may the heavens so shine that they might fairly note this act of mine.
Thou lovest me? Let me see the letter.
Here, Master Baby, grab me another request.
Anything.
Do not desire to see this letter.
But this is to give a dog and a recompense desire of my dog again.
Belonging to the Lady Olivia, friends.
I show you some of her trappings.
I know thee well, thou dost sound like a fellow.
Truly, sir, the better for my foes, and the worst for my friends.
Just the contrary, the better for thy friends.
No, sir, the worst.
How can that be?
Marry, sir, they praise me and make an ass of me. Now for my foes, they tell me plainly I am an ass. That by my foes, I make profit from the knowledge of myself, and by my friends, I am abused.
Why, this is excellent.
By my troth, sir, no. Though it pleases you to be one of my friends.
Thou shalt not be the worst for me. Let's go.
Ooh, but that it would be double dealing, sir. I would, you can make it another.
I will be so much a sinner to be a double dealer. There's another.
Primo, segundo, tertio is a good play. And the old saying is the third pays for all. The triplet, sir, is a good tripping measure. Or the bell to say Benet may put you in mind. One, two, three.
You can fool no more money out of me this throw. Now, to let your lady know that I'm here to speak with her and bring her along with you, which may awake my bounty further.
Oh, marry, sir. A lullaby to your bounty till I come again. I go, sir.
Here comes the man, sir, that did rescue me.
That face of his I do remember well, yet when I saw it last, it was besmeared as black as Vulcan in the smoke of war.
Orsino! This is that Antonio that took the phoenix in her prop from Candy. And this is he that did the tiger board when your young nephew Titus lost his leg here in the streets, desperate of shame and stain. And private rebel did we apprehend him.
He did me kindness, sir. Drew on my side. But in conclusion put a strange speech upon me. I know not what 'twas but distraction.
Notable pirate, thou salt water thief! What foolish boldness brought thee to their mercies, whom thou in terms so bloody and so dear hast made thine enemies?
Orsino, no, sir. Be pleased that I shake off these names you give me. Antonio never yet was a thief or a pirate. Though I confess on basin ground enough. Orsino's enemy, a witchcraft drew me hither. That most ungrateful boy there by your side, from the rude seas and rage and foamy mouth, did I redeem. A red past hope he was, and his life I gave him, and thereto add my love without attention or restraint, all his dedication. For his sake did I expose myself, pure for his love and the danger of this adverse town. Drew to defend him when he was beset,
where being apprehended his false cunning, not meaning to partake with me in danger, taught him to face me out of acquaintance. With a 20-year remove of being while one would wink, denied me mine own purse, which I recommended his use not half an hour before.
How can this be?
When came he to this town?
Today, my lord.
Here comes the Countess.
Oh, now heaven walks on earth. But flee, fellow. Fellow, thy words are madness.
What would, my lord, but that he may not have, when Olivia may seem serviceable? Cesario, you did not keep promise with me.
Madam.
Gracious Olivia.
What do you say, Cesario? Good, my lord.
My lord would speak. My duty hushes me.
If it be aught to the old tune, my lord, it is as fat and fulsome to mine ear as howling after music.
Still so cruel.
Still so constant, lord.
What, to perverseness? You uncivil lady, to whose ingrate and unauspicious altars my soul, the faithfulest offerings hath breathed out that e'er devotion tendered, what shall I do?
Whatever it so please, my lord, that shall become him.
Why should I not, had I depart to do it, like to the Egyptian thief at point of death, kill what I love, a savage jealousy that sometimes savors nobly? But hear me this, since you two non-regardants cast my faith, and that I partly know the instrument that screws me from my true place in your favor, live you the marble-breasted tyrant still. But this, your minion, whom I know you love, and whom, by heaven, I swear I tender dearly, him will I tear out of that cruel eye where he sits crowned in his master's spite. Come, boy, with me. My thoughts are ripe in mischief. I'll sacrifice the lamb that I do love to spite a raven's heart within a dove.
And I, most jocund, apt, and willingly, to do you rest, a thousand deaths would die. Where goes Cesario?
After him I love. More than I love these eyes, more than my life. More by all mores than e'er I shall love wife. If I do feign, you witnesses above, punish my life for tainting of my love.
I be detested. How am I beguiled?
Who does beguile you? Who does do you wrong?
Hast thou forgot thyself? Is it so long? Call forth the Holy Father.
Come away.
Whither, my lord? Cesario, husband, stay.
Husband?
I, husband. Can he that deny?
Her husband, Sira.
No, my lord, not I. Alas, it is the baseness of thy fear that makes thee strangle that crying. Be not afraid, Cesario. Take thy fortunes up. Be that thou knowest thou art, and thou art as great as that thou fearest. Oh, father! Father, father! Father, by thy reverence I charge thee here to unfold, though lately intended to keep in darkness what occasion thou reveals before 'tis ripe, what thou dost know hast newly passed between this youth and me.
A contract of eternal bond of love, confirmed by the mutual joinder of your hands, attested by the holy close of lips, strengthened by the interchange of your rings, and all the ceremony of this compact sealed in my function by my testimony. Since when? My watch have told me. Toward my grave I have traveled but 2 hours.
Ha! Oh, thou dissembling cuff! What wilt thou be when time hath sowed a grizzle on thy case? Farewell, and take her. But direct thy feet, where thou and I henceforth may never meet.
My lord, I do protest. Oh, do not swear. Hold little faith, thou hast too much to fear.
Oh, for the love of God, a surgeon! Send a surgeon presently to Sir Toby.
What's the matter?
He has broke my head for nothing and has given Sir Toby a bloody coxcomb, too. I would for 40 shillings I were at home.
Who has done this, Sir Andrew?
The Count's gentleman, what, Cesario? We took him for a coward, but he's the very devil incarnate.
My gentleman, Cesario?
What? Oh, it's lifelings, here he is. He broke my head for nothing and gave Sir Toby a bloody coxcomb, too. And that which I did, I was set on to do it by Sir Toby.
Why do you speak to me? I never hurt you. You drew your sword upon me without cause, but I would thug you fair and hurt you not.
The bloody coxcomb be a hurt, you have hurt me.
I think you set nothing by a bloody coxcomb. Your cups are totally all thing you shall hear more. If he had not been in drink, he would have tickled you other games than he did.
How now, gentlemen? How is it with you?
That is all one has hurt me, and that's the end of it. Sot! Did see Dick Surgeon Sot?
Oh, he's drunk, Sir Toby, an hour agone. His eyes were set at 8 in the morning.
Then he's a rogue and a passing measures panion. I hate drunken rogue.
Away with him! Who has made this havoc with Beth?
I'll help you, Sir Toby, because we'll be dressed together.
Will you help an asshead and a coxcomb and a knave?
No.
A thin-faced knave and a ghoul.
Get him to bed and let his heart be looked to.
I am sorry, Mother, for I have heard your kinsman. But had it been the brother of my blood, I must have been no, with no less and with in safety.
You do throw a strange regard upon me.
And I do feel I have offended you. Oh, pardon me, sweet one, even for the vows we made each other so late ago.
One face, one voice, one habit, and two persons? A natural perspective that is and is not.
Antonio! Oh, my dear Antonio! Oh, how the hours have dragged and tortured me since I have lost thee. Sebastian, are you? Fearest thou that, Antonio? How have you made a vision of yourself? An apple plucked in two is no more twin than these two creatures. Tell me, which is Sebastian?
Most wonderful!
Do I stand there? I never had a brother, nor can there be that deity in my nature of here and everywhere. I had a sister, whom the blind waves and surges have devoured. Of charity, what kin are you to me? What name, what countryman, what parentage?
Of Messaline. Sebastian was my father. Such a Sebastian was my brother, too. If spirits can assume both form and suit, you come to fright us.
A spirit I am indeed, but am in that dimension grossly clad from which the womb I did participate. Were you a woman, as the rest goes even, I should my tears let fall upon your cheek and say, thrice welcome, drowned Viola.
My father had a mole upon his brow.
And so had mine.
And died that day when Viola from her birth had numbered 13 years.
That record is lively in my soul. That he indeed finished his mortal life that day that made my sister 13 years. So, consec lady, you have been mistook. You would have been contracted to a maid. Both to a maid and a man.
Well, if this be so, as yet the glass seems true, I shall have share in this most happy wreck. Boy, thou hast said to me 1,000 times, thou never shouldest love woman like to me.
And all those sayings will I overswear. And all those sayings keep as true in soul as doth that orbit continent the fire that severs day from night.
Give me thy hand.
And let me see thee in thy woman's weeds.
The captain that first brought me on shore hath my maid's garment. He upon some action is now endurance. At Malvolio suit, a gentleman and follower of my lady's. Oh, he shall enlarge and bring Malvolio hither. Oh, and yet, alas, now I remember me. They say, poor fellow, he is much distract. A most extracting frenzy of mine own to my remembrance. Clearly, that is his. How does he, sirrah?
Truly, madam, he owes Beelzebub at the stage's end. As a man in this case may do, has he writ a letter to you?
Open it, read it.
Look to be well edified when the fool delivers
the madman.
By the law, madam!
Are you out, man?
No, madam, I do but breed madness. And your ladyship will ought to have it be. You must allow box. By the law, madam!
Prithee, read it in thy right wits.
So I do, Madonna. But to read his right wits, you must read thus. By the law, madam!
Read it you, Syrah.
By the Lord, madam, you wrong me, and the world shall know it. Though you have put me into darkness and given your drunken cousin rule over me, yet have I the benefit of my senses as well as your ladyship. I have your own letter that induced me into the semblance I put on, with the which I doubt not to do myself much right or you much shame. Think of me as you please. I leave my duty a little unthought of and speak out of my injury, the madly used.
Did he write this?
Aye, madam.
This savors not much of distraction.
See him delivered, Fabian. Bring him hither.
My lord, so please you, these things further thought on. To think me as well a sister as a wife. One day shall crown the alliance on it, so please you, here at my house and at my proper cost.
Madam, I am most apt to embrace your offer. Your master quits you. And for your service done him, so much against the sense, so far beneath your soft and tender breeding. And since you've called me master for so long, here is my hand. Shall from this time be your master's mistress.
A sister! You are she!
Is this the madman?
Aye, my lord, the same. How now, Malvolio?
You have done me wrong, notorious wrong!
Have I, Malvolio? No.
Lady, you have. Pray you, peruse that letter. You must not now deny it is in your hand. And tell me, in the modesty of honor, why you have given me such clear nights of favor, made me come smiling and cross water to you, to put on yellow stockings and frown upon Sir Toby and the liner people. And, acting this an obedient hope, why have you suffered me to be imprisoned, kept in a dark house, visited by the priests, and made the most notorious gut and gall that e'er invention played on? Tell me, why?
Alas, Malvolio, this is not my writing. Though I confess, much like the character, but 'tis out of question Mariah's hand. Oh, this practice has most shrewdly passed upon me.
Set this device against Malvolio here. Upon some stubborn and uncourteous parts, we conceived against him. Mariah wrote the letter at Sir Toby's great importance. Whereat, in recompense, he hath married her. How, with sportful malice that followed me, rather pluck on laughter than revenge. And if the injuries be justly weighed, they on both sides have passed.
Alas, fool, how they have baffled thee.
Why, some are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust! How are we going for in this interlude? One Sir Toby, sir! That is all one.
By the Lord, fool, I am not mad.
But do you remember? Madam, why laugh you at such a barren rascal, and you smile not? He's gagged. And thus, the whirligig of time brings in his revenges.
I'll be revenged on the whole pack of you.
notoriously abused.
Pursue him and entreat him to a peace. He hath not told us of the captain yet. When that is known and golden time convince, a solemn combination shall be made of our dear souls. In the meantime, sweet sister, we shall not part from hence. Cesario, come. For so you shall be while you are a man, but when in other habits you are seen, Orsino's mistress and his fancy's queen.
You that has a tiny wit with a hay, all the wind and the rain, must be content with this fortune fit, for the rain and every day. And when I say, alas, you why with a hay, all the wind and the rain, then I learn from fast when I think to one, that by swaggery I could never drive long ago. Oh, be gone with a hay, all the wind and the rain. Well, that's all one in our play is done, but we'll strive to please you every day with a hey ho! The wind and the hey ho! The rain and the rain is every day.
Thank you.